So today we're honored to have Beate Judith Wenker, who has been a director of academic affairs at the Chilean British Cultural Institute in Santiago de Chile. Beate held several positions at Yad Vashem, and some of them are member of the German team at the registration department and team leader of archive workers at the Department of the Righteous Among the Nations. Beate currently works at the Jewish Interactive Museum, also in Santiago de Chile, where she is the head of the education department. She's also a guide at the Holocaust Shoah exhibition and the curator of the new permanent Holocaust Shoah exhibition at the same museum. Beate, welcome. Please continue. The name of her presentation today is The Righteous Among the Nations, People Like You and Me. Thank you so much, Beate. Please go ahead.
Thank you very much, Pedro, for the introduction, the presentation. Here I am, for the first time giving a talk in English. Beforehand, I just want to ask you to forgive me if I don't find the right words all of a sudden. A little bit more about myself. I am from Germany originally, and I've lived in different countries, never in an English-speaking country, but in Chile for many years, in Israel, in Brazil. And until 2016, I was living in Israel, and as Pedro explained to you, I was working in Yad Vashem. I was also a tour guide, a museum guide there. Okay, the topic of today is The Righteous Among the Nations. I don't know if you're familiar with the term. Righteous Among the Nations is a title that is awarded by Yad Vashem to non-Jews who helped and saved the lives of Jews during the Holocaust. And in the pictures, you can see three representatives of this group from the left to the right. It's we will talk about them in detail. She is Maria Edwards, a Chilean who worked as a social worker and nurse in France. In the middle, we have Wilhelm Hosenfeld. He was a Wehrmacht officer and saved the pianist, the famous pianist from the movie, The Pianist, Ladislav Spielmann. And on the right side, we have the Queen of Belgium, Queen Elizabeth of Belgium. Three of them have in common that they saved Jews, that were non-Jews. Let me see if I can go on. Okay, what we can see in this picture is a beautiful place at the Yad Vashem campus, which is the garden of the Righteous Among the Nations. In Hebrew, the Righteous Among the Nations are called Chasidei Umot HaOlam. And in this place are, I don't know if you can see my arrow here, there are some walls on the sides where the names of the righteous are inscribed. Also the ceremonies take place here. What I want to read you shortly is a portion from the official introduction about the Righteous Among the Nations from Yad Vashem. And it says like this, when Adolf Hitler and his Nazi party came to power in Germany, that was in 1933, anti-Semitism became the official state policy. The Nazi regime started to systematically liquidate the Jewish communities in the countries they occupied and controlled. 6 million Jews, including 1.5 million children, were murdered in the countries of Europe controlled by Nazi Germany during World War II. Most of the Europeans under Nazi rule either kept silent or stood by or collaborated with the murderers. Relatively few tried to help the Jews. Now, I think, obviously, the topic of the Righteous Among the Nations is quite a positive topic. So we think of other things we sometimes have to talk about are crucial to the Holocaust, right? So what I will try to do, I think it's quite difficult, to find out if these people have somehow, the Righteous Among the Nations have somehow something in common, what made them act like that. Now, I have to say, as Pedro said, I worked for the Department of the Righteous Among the Nations, And I was so lucky to have access to at least 3,000 files of the righteous. And I'm not an historian, I'm a linguist, by the way, originally, but I took some notes and I got very curious. I could read the testimonies the righteous gave to Yad Vashem. And I found it very interesting to see how different these people were according to their testimonies. So what I will do, I will talk a little bit about some theory of psychologists and sociologists, and present you a number of righteous among the nations and their stories. Okay, what about the title? The title, Righteous Among the Nations. This title was established by the Israeli parliament, the Knesset, as part of the Yad Vashem law in 1953. Now the Yad Vashem law said that the Jewish people had to honor, the victims, the heroes of the Holocaust, but also the righteous among the nations, people who had saved the Jews. So this is very important to state that the righteous were part, that were already considered as a part of this law. Now the origin of the name stems from Maimonides, the famous philosopher and doctor and rabbi, who said in the 12th, 13th century, he said, anyone who accepts upon himself and carefully observes the seven commandments is of the righteous of the nations of the world and has a portion in the world to come. Now this he wrote in Hilchot HaMalechim, which means the laws of the kings. Now the seven commandments, I'm not so familiar with the religion, but I understand these are the commandments Jews understand were given by God to the rest of humanity, right? The Jews have to follow more laws than that. So righteous among the nations comes from there. And in 1963, Yad Vashem started to grant this title. Actually, one of the first people who was recognized by Yad Vashem was Oskar Schindler. You probably remember him from Schindler's List. He actually was file number 20, if I'm not wrong. So quite one of the first ones. And what you can see in the picture is the certificate or diploma that the righteous receive, or their relatives, if they already passed away, and a medal. And on the medal, there is an engraved saying from the Mishnah. This is also Holy Scriptures of Judaism. Whosoever saves a single life saves an entire universe. And this is so, expresses so well the essence of this title. It doesn't matter if the righteous saved one life or thousands of lives, as in some cases, they are equally righteous among the nations. Yad Vashem has recognized so far 27,712 people. These numbers are from 2020, and I show you here some pictures of righteous, of the rescuers with the people they rescued. And you can already see from the different pictures what kind of different backgrounds they have. People, farmers, a nun you can see here. And in the middle, we can see a little boy with his sister, so to say, from the family he was rescued by. It is also very interesting to see how important the rescuers are for the Jews that were rescued. And I present here the example of Primo Levi. You probably know the famous Italian Jew. He was a chemist. He wrote lots of books about the Holocaust after the war. And he was saved by an Italian bricklayer who happened to work at the Auschwitz. They needed workers to make an extension of the camp. And they became friendly because they found out that they were from the same area in Italy, from Turin. They spoke the same dialect. And Lorenzo started giving him some of his food ration and clothing and helped in this way to survive. But Primo Levi says something more about him. He says, I think it was really due to Lorenzo that I am alive today. And not so much for his material aid, but for having constantly reminded me by his presence, by his natural and plain manner of being good, that there existed a just world outside ours, our own. Sorry. Something and someone still pure and whole, worth surviving for. Lorenzo was a man. His humanity was pure and uncontaminated. He was outside this world of negation. Thanks to Lorenzo, I managed not to forget that I myself was a man. This he wrote in his first book, maybe the most famous one, If This Is a Man, in 1947. And we can see a picture from the liberation of Auschwitz. So all his life, Primo Levi was grateful to his rescuer. He even called his daughter Lisa Lorenza and his son Renzo. So he was very grateful indeed. Now the title Righteous Among the Nation is given through a commission at Yad Vashem, which is composed of a limited number of people, and the president is usually a justice from the Supreme Court. And there are four criteria that were established, and they are conditions upon which the title is awarded. Now, the people, the candidates, we could say, must not be Jewish. This is an award for non-Jewish people. They must have offered aid without receiving any kind of award. This is important because there have been many actions of rescue by people who were paid for it, maybe only a little money. But in this case, the idea is that these people did not receive anything. They must have risked his or her life. Right. This, in the case of the diplomats, is a bit different. The big diplomats usually did not risk their lives, but the criterion here is that they must have acted against the explicit instruction of their governments. And of course, the rescue must be documented by witnesses. Okay, these are the four criteria that are the basis for the recognition. Okay, let's go a little bit, just a little bit. I told you I'm a linguist, I'm not a psychologist, not a historian, to look what concepts have been established in history that have to do with principles, concepts that the helpers, rescuers base their actions on. Auguste Comte, he was a French philosopher from the 19th century. He created actually the concept of altruism. Altruism from Latin alca, the other, the act of selflessly caring for others. Now he took this principle very seriously, because he said that only actions for the benefit of others would be really happiness and so forth. Émile Durkheim, another Frenchman from the 19th century, he was a sociologist. He said, altruism is not merely an agreeable ornament to social life, but its fundamental basis. This is a more pragmatic approach that means society doesn't work without altruism. I had a look at an article by Karen Kaddish from 2 years ago, The Psychology of Rescuers During the Holocaust. And she quotes Mark Klempner, who is a historian and folklorist, you say. And he says that the rescuers, because he did research about their stories, they have three characteristics in common. One is that they had a role model in their childhood. For example, someone who had gone out of their way to help others. This may have been a parent or a teacher. These people learned not to draw a line between us and them, not to exclude others. Now, if we think about ourselves, probably we have had such role models too in their lives. I, for instance, have. The second point is that they were able to think for themselves, act independently on their own convictions, disregard public opinion, make their own choices. This is very important. They were independent thinkers, not dependent on any public opinion or prejudice. And the third point, that they learned not to overthink things too much. This I found quite interesting. This means that they should not follow initial feelings. They should follow initial feelings without analyzing too long. That means the first impulse, I want to help, should not be analyzed too much. If not, people maybe would become more aware of the dangers, the risk that implied. Eva Fogelman, she's an American psychologist, a specialist in research about rescues. She examined many cases of rescues, and she comes to similar conclusions regarding the profile of the rescuers. They have a heightened sense of empathy, have had loving homes, no fear of authority, could think independently what was right or wrong. 80% had an altruistic role model from their families, you see, the same as was said before. 90% learned to learn tolerance, acceptance of difference from their parents. Mm-hmm. Now, what Eva Fogelman does, she establishes five profiles of rescuers during the Holocaust. And I will do something which is not very scientifically correct, but since I had access to really lots of testimonies and took some notes, I reconstructed or constructed some quotes. They're not quotes because I reconstruct them that correspond to the different types of rescuers. The first group is the moral rescuers. Now she divides them into religious rescuers. And what I put in the blue boxes is something that such a religious rescuer might have said, and actually said very often, love your neighbor the same as you love yourself. Or a Buddhist maybe, do not undo others what you do not want others to do unto you. These people were motivated by these principles. Spiritual rescuers would say, life is sacred. The purpose of life is to serve. We must feel compassion and the willingness to help others. This is very often the righteous said this. Sorry, I have to move something. Emotional rescuers could have said, I felt sorry for the children. I had to help. I felt pity. Those people were innocent. Someone had to take responsibility. The second group are the Judeophile rescuers, what a word. People who like Jews, for example, neighbors or friends. Our neighbors were Jewish and we were friends. At no point did we think not to help them. Or I'm a Bible scholar and I have always admired the Jewish people. There are people who said this in the testimonies. Concerned professionals, right, like lawyers, doctors, a dentist, for example, said, I made no difference between Jewish and non-Jewish patients, or the diplomat. As a consul, I was used to solving problems with the Jewish refugees. We took it a little further because we were well aware of their situation. And there are several examples for that. The rescuer networks, there were networks in Holland, especially in the Netherlands or in France. Our groups were active in churches, universities, and political parties. We protested against the Nazi regime and carried out sabotage. Helping the Jews came as a logical consequence. And the last group are the child rescuers, she calls them. Those were rescuers who were children when these things happened. And one of them said, I was very young, only helping my parents. However, I understood that I didn't have to talk to anyone about the lady who was hiding in the basement. Now this, you can imagine, was very, very difficult to control children who were witnessing these actions because they went out in the street, talked to neighbors, to friends, very dangerous. It was very dangerous, but there was also a bit of adventure to it. In those days, I used to think like that, typical thought of someone who was a child in those days. Okay. There is another investigation by Dali and Latané, classical one, which I adapted, the five steps of a rescue. Now, this seems to be quite schematic, but I'll explain it to you. The first step in a situation where there is a threat and danger for people who are persecuted, somebody has to notice that something is happening. The second step is to interpret that this event is an emergency. The third point, take responsibility for the situation. The fourth one, decide how to provide help. And obviously the last one, take action to provide help. Now this looks very simple, but imagine for example, a farmer's wife in Poland, and one day suddenly some Jews that ran away from a ghetto knocked on the door, and it was obviously that they needed help. So this person, this woman, they're all often women because they were the ones that stayed at home, the men would work in the fields. They had to make all these five steps in a matter of seconds probably, which was quite problematic. Very often their husbands came home and did not agree with her actions. But that's just an example. Right, now the question is here that we can see that I saw it during my work at Yad Vashem, that the profiles, the socioeconomic profile of the rescues is really very diverse. If you have a look at this collection, these are actually professions or creeds of people who are recognized as righteous among the nations. I will just quote some because just to help those who cannot read it well, a priest, a German soldier, a doctor, a Muslim, a dentist, a musician, a zoo director, etc. So all of these different profiles can be found in these 28,000 and so files. And an example, I'm showing here a picture of Adolf Althoff. He was a German circus owner. He owned one of the most famous and oldest circuses in Europe. And he, during 5 years, he saved, he protected four Jewish artists. You can see one in the picture, Irene Danner. She worked in the circus. I don't know exactly what she did, but Althoff gave this family members a new identity and gave them work. They could work under a false name. And the other picture you can see Althoff with his wife Maria. So, what is the profile of the righteous? Good question. Maybe we can find it out with the help of all these precepts we defined at the beginning, maybe not. And just as an example to start with, I want to show you Oskar Schindler. Oskar Schindler, he came from Austria, you know, he's a very famous case. Deborah Lipstadt, the American historian, she calls him the rogue righteous. I like this very original name, the rogue righteous. Why? Because look at this. He was a member of the German intelligence service. He was a member of the Nazi party. In several pictures, you can see the Nazi party pin on his jackets. He bought an Aryanized, so-called Aryanized factory. That means he took advantage of this and also of the work of Jewish slave laborers. And initially, as we know, he acted for his own benefit. And he was also a drinker and womanizer. We sometimes, forget that his wife Emilia was also recognized as the righteous among the nations. And she didn't say many nice things about him. On the other hand, he's buried in Jerusalem. You can see a picture from his funeral. And lots of Jews who called themselves the Schindler Juden, who were saved by him and were very grateful and helped him during all his life. Some of the more sort of famous righteous among the nations, for example, Raoul Wallenberg from Sweden. He was a diplomat in Budapest on a special mission. And through his work, he could prevent the deportation of tens of thousands of Hungarian Jews to Auschwitz-Birkenau. He gave out certificates, protection certificates. He also created hospitals and safe houses. He's just put the Swedish flag, was declared this is a Swedish territory, and the Nazis respected this. Now he, after the war, was arrested because of suspicion of espionage, and simply disappeared. It was never really clarified where and when and how he died. Raoul Wallenberg. Irina Sendler, another famous case. She was a social worker in Poland and member of the children's section of Zygota. Zygota was the Jewish, the Polish Council for the Help of Jews, and they had a children's department, children's section, who helped smuggle out children from the Warsaw ghetto. Now, what they did, they sedated the children, hid them like this little baby in the picture, Elzbieta Fikowska, in boxes with holes. Now, this is a picture from a movie, it's not a real one. And found foster families, Christian families who took in these Jewish children and took care of them. She was arrested, she was tortured. She was also rescued by members of Zivota and died at a very old age. Why do I have this jar here? Because what she did, she noted down the real names of all the children they got out of the Warsaw ghetto and put them in the jar. And so after the war, they could find out their real identities because they had false names. Now we come to some examples of not so famous writers among the nations, like the Queen of Belgium, which was on the initial slide. Now she was originally a German princess and married the Belgian king, became queen, and had of course contacts, good contacts to the German invaders, and made use of this and saved this way hundreds of Jewish children. Not very known this case. I have some pictures here of Jews from Belgium that were saved. And Leopold Socha, he was a Polish sewer worker. That means he worked in the worst place you can imagine. He had to work. And he one day, together with a colleague, met a group of Jews. There were 20 some Jews hidden there. They had escaped from the ghetto of Lvov and actually stayed there for 14 months. And first, Leopold Socha helped them and got money for that. But after a short time, the Jews didn't have any more money to pay him. So they continued, he, his colleague, and their wives, to help these Jews hidden there. And it's not such a happy end story, because half of these Jews died. There was a baby born that died. Here it says Socha was also a thief, which is true. He was a very simple person, but he had good principles and good concepts and helped these people. Even when people died, they took care of their burials and not only gave them food and clean water, but also some artifacts for the Jews to practice their religion, which was quite special. I have here a little movie. There's a movie about this story, which is called In Darkness by Agnieszka Holland. Maybe some of you have seen it. I can just play it. It's the trailer.
W tygodniu pana żona nie miała jeszcze ani grosza.
Co nagrodę, jak to wskaże Żyda. Kupa leży niezły pieniądz na tym robi.
Bóg mi za to skaże.
Znalazłem Żydów! Żydzi! Znalazłem Żydów!
Od samego początku pod moim nosem ukryłeś Żydowa! Zdradziłeś mnie! Nastawiam życie swoje, mojej formuły w imię czego.
To był Spider-Man. To?
Okay. Leopold died after the war, shortly after the war, tragically in an accident in the street. But you can see how courageous these people were. I mean, it was in Poland, it was extremely dangerous to help Jews, and they did more than just help them. Yes. Right. Here I have another righteous. She was Dr. Adelaide Oval from France. That is an interesting story too. She was arrested by the Gestapo because she crossed the frontier between the occupied France and Vichy France illegally. She was arrested, and when she was arrested, she complained loudly about how the Germans were treating the Jews. Make a long story short, she was sent to Auschwitz as a friend of the Jews. That was the category. And being at Auschwitz, she wore this little bracelet I put on the picture, which says "Ami des Juifs," a friend of the Jews. So she wore this all the time. And as it says here, she provided medical care to women in the Auschwitz-Birkenau camp, and she refused to participate in medical experiments. Now, she survived. They didn't punish her, so to say, for that. And she survived. And after the war, she wrote books and gave talks about her experience. This monk, Daniel Cimino, was, nobody knows him, basically. He was the director of an orphanage in Uniów in Poland, too. And he saved three Jewish children by giving them false identities. This was also very dangerous. The Germans used to raid these places. And he also baptized them to protect them. He explained them that they were Jews and they would remain Jews, but it was safer for them if they were baptized. So you can see him here in the picture with a group of orphans. We don't know if some of the rescued children are among those in the picture. Wilhelm Rosenfeld, he was also on the first initial slide. He was a Wehrmacht officer. He was already like 40 something when he was sent to war. He was originally a school teacher. Here we can see him with one of his five children. And he was the one who saved the pianist Vladislav Spielmann, as I said at the beginning, and three other Jewish and non-Jewish poets. Now, if you've seen the movie by Roman Polanski, the pianist, you'll probably remember the scene when the pianist is there half dead and trying to open a can of something, and he doesn't have a can opener, and this man came, he plays for him on the piano. So after the war, Spielmann tried to find him because he was very grateful to him, because Rosenfeld was a prisoner of war in the Soviet Union. He became sick and he died finally in 1952. I mean, after many years as a prisoner of war. So this was a special story. Olansky thought this was worth making a movie of it. And let me see if we have a trailer here to show you the pianist. So I've seen it, we'll remember at the very end of the short scene, you can see the officer, I mean the actor.
This is the greatest pianist in Poland, maybe the whole world.
No one plays Chopin like you.
Well, that's a compliment.
By order of the governor of the Warsaw district, there will be created a Jewish district in which all Jews will have to reside.
You must get away at once. I'm not leaving. Can't I take my chances here? But I have to keep moving you. The Germans are hunting down indiscriminately now.
Keep as quiet as possible. No one knows you're here.
I want to help. I want to do something.
Don't let them get you alive.
If you prick us, do we not bleed? If you tickle us, do we not laugh? If you poison us, do we not die? And if you wrong us, shall we not revenge?
Well, like Oskar Schindler, Wim Hosemann was also a member of the Nazi Party. Sorry, there's something here now. Oof. Okay, I'm sorry for this. Sorry for this. Just go through this again. He was a member of the Nazi Party, and he was also a member of the Nazi organization of teachers. So he was basically a Nazi, a convinced Nazi. But in this situation, he showed that he had shall we call it a good heart or stable principles that he learned in childhood. We don't know, but he did what he did. And now I show you. A representative of the diplomats that acted in the Holocaust and saved Jews. Here we have Aristides de Sousa Mendes. He was the Portuguese consul in Bordeaux in France. He had a very large family. He had like 13 children. And during a few days and nights, he gave out just visas for Jews who wanted to go to flee to Portugal. Through France, right, to freedom. And he had to bear hard consequences for his actions because the official instruction was not to give visas to Jews, but he did it anyway. And he said, we don't know exactly how many Jews he saved, but they say it was like thousands of Jews he saved. After the war, he wasn't treated very well in Portugal, and he died actually very poor. He was a lawyer, but he couldn't work any longer as a lawyer, so he paid very hard for his action to save the Jews. And here is a young girl, interesting story, not very famous. Her name was Ida Brunelli. She was a teenager, and she was a babysitter, basically, a nanny. She cared for three children of an artist family. Both parents were artists, musicians, and a dancer. The mother was a dancer. They came from Hungary. The man had to serve in the Hungarian army, and the mother died of a heart disease. So the children were left on their own, and she decided, she was then maybe 17 years old. She decided to take care of these children. Here we have a picture. She's in a boat with her three children and took them to her mother's home. And with the help of local authorities, they could save them. Later on, I will show you a portion of her testimony to Yad Vashem, how she explained her actions in a very, very simple way, just at the age of 17, she took care of three kids. Now, I am living in Chile for many, many years. I have been living here. And in Chile, we have two righteous among the nations recognized by Yad Vashem. One was also a diplomat, Samuel del Campo. He was a consul in Bucharest, in Romania, and issued passports to persecuted Jews. And of course, also the Chilean government didn't like this. Actually, that we have letters, correspondence within the diplomatic world. There was a prejudice. They didn't want to accept Jews. They even found that the mixture between Jews and native Chileans from the south would be an ugly mixture, things like that. So he acted against these instructions, like his colleague from Portugal, and also was removed from the diplomatic service. We don't even know where and when he actually died. And the other one is Maria Edwards McClure. The story is very interesting. She came from a very, very wealthy family as a wife of a diplomat. Her husband died. They were living in Paris. And she volunteered as a social worker, also as a nurse at the Rothschild Hospital, which was the Jewish hospital in Paris. And there were many Jewish children that were surely to be deported to Auschwitz. She became a member of the resistance. And in a similar manner as Elena Sandler, the smuggled out children, right? The small children, she hid them under her coat and took them out. Around 80 Jewish children were saved by her. And also the Gestapo became suspicious about her. She was arrested and she was also tortured in her own home, but she didn't give away any name. Her family in Chile asked her to come back to Chile. They said, what are you doing there in that country? There's war in Europe, you're from South America. What are you doing there? But she didn't obey. She continued her rescue actions during the whole war. And I found that there are also, I didn't remember very well, some American, exactly five American Righteous Among the Nations. The first actually to be recognized was Varian Fry. Now, he was a foreign correspondent in Berlin, and he just couldn't help saved hundreds of Jewish refugees and helped them to escape from Nazi Germany. And he also founded a rescue network in Vichy, France. And it's amazing. He saved many well-known people, among others, Marc Chagall and Hannah Arendt. I just want to read to you a letter he sent to his wife from France, a letter to his wife, Eileen, in February 1941. He writes, among the people who have come into my office or with whom I am in constant correspondence are not only some of the greatest living authors, painters, sculptors of Europe, but also former cabinet ministers and even prime ministers of half a dozen countries. What a strange place Europe is when men like these are reduced to waiting patiently in the anteroom of a young American of no importance whatever. Varian Fry. So it's amazing to see what these people did, the risks they took, right? And here I want to show you an example of a case that is maybe a little bit polemic and controversial, Sir Nicholas Winton from the United Kingdom. He was, as it says here, a banker, philanthropist, and rescued almost 700 children from Czechoslovakia at the time to Great Britain. He was knighted. He got a lot of awards also from Czechoslovakia, a special cross, and he died not long ago at the age of 106 years. Now, why wasn't he recognized? I remember I had the file in the office and my boss said to me, don't open it yet, they are still discussing and we don't know what happens. Anyway, we also had to check the files of people who were not recognized, but it was there, I remember in my office, I saw it all the time and became curious and opened and read the story. So the thing was that Sir Nicholas was born as a son of two people who were originally Jews, but who converted to Christianism at a young age, and he was raised as a Christian, right? So this was the reason why Yad Vashem decided that actually he was not a non-Jew, basically to say it like that. But also I want to mention him because not only people who were recognized as righteous among the nations behaved bravely, right? We don't know. There are so many anonymous cases, but because people don't become automatically righteous among the nations, somebody has to apply for the status. Somebody has to want to document it. And as time goes by, it's much more difficult. The eyewitnesses have passed away already. So he, in representation of those who were not recognized, we can see him here in a picture with a child in 1939 and in 2014. So there is a movie, maybe you have seen it, of a British TV program. I can show you this immediately. Maybe I've seen it sometime.
All the letters. But back here is the list of all the children. This is Vera Diamant, now Vera Gissing. We did find her name on his list. Vera Gissing is with us here tonight. Hello, Vera. And I should tell you that you are actually sitting next to Nicholas Winton.
Hello. And it was just so wonderful, so terribly, terribly touching.
Can I ask, is there anyone in our audience tonight who owes their life to Nicholas Winton? If so, could you stand up, please?
Okay. All right. So I think this video is very emotional. Every time I see it, I find it so emotional. He was a very humble person. Even his wife didn't know about the lists of children he had kept at some place at his home. Right. So already getting to the end, what can we do now? Can we say that the writers have common features? Now, what does have a queen, a sewer worker, doctor, German soldier, monk, a student, diplomat, and others? What do they have in common? Basically, not much. And also, we don't know much often about the people themselves. We don't know if they had role models in their youth, if they were resilient. We don't know these things generally. Now, what they have in common, obviously they saved Jews and they took a high risk for that. Here a little bit of statistic. First, the picture. The picture you can see here is the entrance to the Garden of the Righteous. And there are two trees that were planted in honor of Raoul Wallenberg, the Swedish diplomat who disappeared, and Irena Sendler, the Polish social worker. Now, I have to add that until the 90s at Yad Vashem, they used to plant a little tree for each righteous, right? But with so many, thank God, righteous among the nations, it was a logistic problem, I guess, to take care of all the trees. So now there are these walls in the Garden of the Righteous where their names are engraved, inscribed. So here we have the countries, the 10 countries with most righteous recognized. There's Poland in the first place, and Holland and France for the most, right? But also Ukraine, Belgium, Lithuania, Hungary, Italy, Belarus, and Germany. Those are the first 10. But there are righteous from more than 45 or 46 countries. USA, as I said, 5, and in Latin America, there are 9. They are generally diplomats. And to finish, I just want to show you the simple testimony that Ida Brunelli, the 17-year-old teenager who saved these three children, gave to Yad Vashem. He said, I was Fiorenza Lisetta and Alessandro's nanny. Before the mother passed away, she made me promise that I would take care of the children. I took them to my mother's house where we raised them with the help of the local authorities. When we found their relatives in Palestine, I had to say goodbye to them. The youngest one was crying, running after me, calling my name, but I couldn't go with them. This is and a little bit more. It's the only thing she, in a very simple and humble way, wrote in her testimony. And Irena Sendler, who said, I did what had to be done. I should have saved more. Actually, she said that so many times when she was asked about her experience. No, she always, during her whole life, she had this feeling that she could have, should have saved more people. And Oskar Schindler said, I had to help them. There was no choice. Okay, and that is the end. I hope this has been interesting, useful for you. I put down a part of my personal experience working with the testimonies. And personally, I came to the conclusion that we cannot like scientifically establish a common profile of the righteous among the nations. What they had in common, which much more important, they saved, as I said before, they said Jews who were threatened and taking the terrible risk they did. And many paid with their life, by the way. All right, so.
All right, thank you so much, Beate. I hope everyone joins me in a round of applause for a great presentation, even if it's only virtually. Thank you so much. So we have a few minutes for questions, and I'm gonna start reading some of them. This is one that I wanna somehow compliment. It says, recently there have been many controversial cases. From your time at Yad Vashem, do you notice cases where the committee did not accept the accounts of the survivors or diplomats who were not accepted and who did not risk their lives? I would add, because of the time that we have, if you can talk about the Mexican case of Gilberto Bosques, if you know anything about that.
Not so much. I would prefer to answer the other question.
Okay, all right.
Right.
Okay.
I have to say that my job was very simple. It was not an academic research work. I worked for the pre-digitalization section of the Righteous Among the Nations. And what we had to do, we had to separate the papers that could maybe be published further on, even on online, and the ones that wouldn't be published, like the minutes of the meetings of the commissions, right? I read them, they were in Hebrew, but I could do this. And that was interesting to read. I mean, I couldn't make and I wouldn't publish this because that was not my job. But a certain amount of applications were rejected. And of course, it was interesting to see the reasons. Generally, it had to do with the risk, right? With the type of risk that was taken. Or if the witnesses could not be sort of trusted in a way. I remember a case of where the only eyewitness was a young boy of 8 years old. And that was quite a controversial case. In the end, the person was accepted, but there were many who said an eight-year-old boy cannot have such a good memory, can change the versions, whatever. So it is complicated. Since I had access to the files that were not recognized, that was interesting to see. But I wouldn't like to comment on that because that was not my job to do that.
All right, okay. Are there any righteous from Argentina?
No. Now I know them almost by heart. There are two from Peru, there's one from El Salvador, two from Chile. It's 9 in all, it's not so many.
Okay. Then we have another question. Is Chiune Sugihara one of the righteous? I yes. know that he risked his job, but not sure about the risk of his life.
Yes, I don't know the details about the risk, but he's a very famous case right now. There's a movie about him, Persona non grata. I haven't seen it yet, but he was the Japanese consul in Lithuania, and he saved thousands and thousands of lives. He's Japanese, yes. Now, as I said, the diplomats had immunity. They didn't usually risk their lives, right? Some paid very hard, as I said, like the Portuguese consul and the Chilean one, and their career ended. For example, Sousa Mendes, he was so poor that he was buried in a monk's clothes, and only in recent years he has been rehabilitated.
All right, we have another really good question. What percentage were women of the award winners?
That's a good question. I don't know the exact number, but they are a little more than 50%. A little more women than men were recognized. That has to do really with what the example I gave at the beginning, that very often in the situations where people looked desperately for help and they came to houses and the person who was at home was a woman. I don't think we can draw conclusions that they were, that women were more courageous or so. I don't know, so I wouldn't say that. But statistically, a little more women, yes.
All right, thank you. I have a question. And I really like the perspective, right? Because you mentioned that you're not a historian, but a linguist. So that provides a very, I don't know, refreshing insight in this type of conversation. So you work at a museum, and I wanted to know, can we somehow form the righteous? You did mention something about this, but is there anything that we can do to have more people like this that risk a lot in order to save others, based on your experience at the museum?
You mean that that we should find more people who deserve to be recognized?
No. If we can somehow produce more people who feel this responsibility to do more, and is not disengaged from society and the problems that we see, you know, ongoing problems all over the world.
Yes, as you mentioned at the beginning, right now here in Chile, we are building a new museum, Holocaust section. We just 2 days ago had a kind of pre-inauguration, and we have like three conceptual lines in the museum, and one of them are the Righteous Among the Nations. We show them all the time in white showcases to show that in dark times there were people who risked even their lives to save others. And our visitors are mainly, like 80% are school children, like 80% non-Jewish school children. And I think it is very important for them to learn that these people existed, so that it was possible to be good, to know the difference between good and bad. I think it's a very educational, very important educational aspect.
All right, thank you. So we are almost getting to the end of the event. I wanted to ask if you have any other comments, something that you would like to repeat or state in order to wrap this presentation up before we leave.
I don't know, I didn't prepare any sentence, but I was very surprised about this aspect that sometimes in situations where you have the chance to help others, people are in an emergency, don't think for too long, just act. If you know what's good and right and what is wrong, do the right thing. Don't think too much. And nowadays we have so many, as you said, so many situations where injustices happen. And we have to open our mouths. We have to show what is right and what is wrong. And that's what we can learn from that aspect of the Holocaust.
Thank you so much. It has been a great pleasure to have you here to listen to this presentation. I hope we can have another event and have a, you know, again, a lot of people attending and learning from you and from our colleagues in Chile. So thank you so much, Beate. It was really
pleasure.
Great.
Thanks for inviting me. Thank you so much.
Thank you, everyone.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.